Fantasy and Color Podcast. We are back, episode 4. We just want to let y'all know from the jump, we live from the Bronx, and there's a Bronx dog outside. We don't know who they are, but you might hear them from time to time. But
they definitely gonna hear it.
That's just them chiming in the conversation. Don't worry about it. So we back. What's up? I'm Rob AYALA.
I'm Kadeem PHILLIP.
And we here. This is kind of like the relaunch. Last year we did 3 episodes, but now we about to come consistently. Kind of a new direction, but we're definitely going to be doing interviews as well.
Exactly. Just taking a pulse on the culture, what's going on, talking about different topics, art, music, culture. You know, just giving our standpoints on stuff.
So with that being said, let's just jump right into it.
Mm-hmm.
What is art? Because that's used very loosely these days. And not only what is art, what is an artist?
I feel art is being used super broad nowadays. And I feel that being an artist is kind of like super stretched out and broadened. So it's like, it's kind of hard to term. But I feel like an artist is a person who uses some vehicle of expression to really get across a thought, feeling, emotion. But it's music, dance, you know, drawing, painting. I feel that's an artist. And I feel someone who's really dedicated to craft, trying to improve and just get out what they got to feel. That's okay. An artist to me.
So you said music, you said dance,
poetry,
painting,
writing, all that stuff. All those are the art.
Yeah. I think in the simplest term, I think it's art is any form of creative expression.
Yeah.
If it's somewhat creative and you can express it, then it's art. Yeah. So writing is art.
Acting is art. Graffiti, yeah. Acting. Yeah, acting is art. I think a lot of questions come around acting. I think a lot of people question are actors, artists.
Yeah, but they are.
They are.
They call themselves artists, mm-hmm. I believe.
Because you got to get into that role. Like, Heath Ledger, when he got into that Joker role, he went deep into
exactly.
that.
Exactly.
Then they drove himself insane. So exactly. I feel like when you look at an artist, it's what you love and how you get, I feel how you feel the freest and how you express yourself.
So we said art was used freely.
Mm-hmm.
I think the word artist is even used even
too
more
damn
freely. So what do you think? So now we know what art is. What does it take to be an artist?
In today's style.
Can anybody be an artist?
I don't fucking know. It feels like it.
No, but seriously, can anybody be an artist?
I feel
not even sarcastically. Because I know sarcastically everybody's an artist.
Yeah, sarcastically.
But can everybody be an artist? If we're saying it's just creative expression?
I feel so. I feel like to really be recognized as an artist, you have to be exceptional. I feel to really be
to be a good artist.
To be a really good artist or a great artist, you have to be exceptional.
So wait, stop. Mm-hmm. That leads me to this. So that's what it is. And I think that's what people debate.
Mm-hmm.
So does it have to be good art to be considered art? Do you have to be a great artist to be considered artist?
No.
Isn't bad art still art?
Yeah.
Isn't a horrible artist that, and it's just an opinion. If it's an artist that, because let's be real, everybody wants to act positive, but everybody has their opinions on shit.
Some
things you might just think suck to you, your taste.
Some shit that is trash.
Like, to you and your taste, exactly. But everybody.
Yeah.
I might have shit to me that's trash. But does that make it not art?
No. It's still art. It's still expression. I can't tell someone how to express their pain. I can't tell someone how to express the depression. And just because you just do it for the first time and it might not be well, it might take time. Everybody gets to a point.
All right, cut the bullshit. A white canvas with a black line through it. Is that art?
Fuck no.
Why not? You just said all those other beautiful things.
Well, here's what I'll say. On the other spectrum of that, there are certain plays where people use the term artist to really just make money. So I feel like when I see someone and they're just like a black, a blue dot on a white canvas, I feel like you just trying to come
yeah, but,
up
but,
fake beat.
But that was a error. Don't quote me, but I think it was like in the 70s at some point there was a minimal era where that's what it was like for a minute.
And it's trash, but at the same point, you know, I feel like you could tell who's really into it. I could feel like
so whoever did that those kind of paintings, are they still an artist? To you? Are they not an artist?
To me, no. Okay. Like, you just do, like, a blue, a dye. Like, it's like, I can understand.
So, to you, you have to be, there has to be a certain level of skill for you to consider the person an artist.
There has to be. For me, it's a certain level of skill. One, what are you trying to explain? Like, if I ask you about it, I don't want to hear some fake shit that just sound deep. And then, two, it's like, two, it's just the fact of, like, does it feel genuine to you? Because I feel like a lot of artists do shit just to because it's popular.
Yeah.
At the same point, like, I might say a blue dot on a white canvas ain't shit to me, but a Jackson Pollock painting speaks to me, and that's a lot of splatters just on a canvas.
And somebody might say that's...
Right, but to me, that's just, like, an expression of, like, maybe something. Like, if it's just red splatters on a canvas, it might be rage. It might be something.
So, you know,
like
Subway, the sandwich store, right? You know those are called sandwich artists, right?
Yeah.
Those artists? That's a bullshit question. I'm bullshit. Don't answer that. But anyway, so I think more or less, to me... Mm-hmm. I hear what you're saying, but I think, just to be fair, I think anybody can be an artist. It just doesn't mean you're a good artist.
Yeah.
So anything could be art. If you call it art to you and you think you made it, just like, let's be real, just like a little kid who's 3-4 mm-hmm. years old, they make something and that's their art and they bring it to you.
Yeah.
It probably sucks, but that's their art.
Kids are naturally artists at first. I feel like kids are all artists. I just feel like as we grow up, society just fucks us up to the point we kind of pull away from the creativity.
Yeah.
That's how I feel.
That's interesting because...
Do you feel a person that traces is an artist?
What do you mean trace?
Like if somebody, they trace something, are they an artist?
Well, I know what trace means, but give me an example. Like
legit put the translucent paper over something and just trace like the image. Like
on a canvas?
Like on a canvas, a piece of paper, and they call themselves an artist.
They're tracing. Is it their image they drew out?
No.
What are they tracing?
Somebody else's image.
But that's weird. I don't know. Who does that?
Yeah,
I can't even acknowledge that as a thing.
Like, you never seen somebody trace something?
Like stencil?
Like stencil or like copy somebody's work. Like just put like a piece of paper over like an image somebody did and just copy it. Like just follow the lines. You never seen that?
I mean, I've seen stencil work, but not like straight tracing though.
Oh, I've seen straight tracing multiple times. I've seen a lot of people do that.
Yeah.
Like I find that if you tracing stuff, you're not an artist.
Nah, yeah. A stencil is different because that is an art in itself. Mm-hmm. I mean, Banksy does a lot of stencil work. You can...
Oh, yeah, that's different.
And there's different levels with that.
But what I mean is, like, say somebody puts a piece of paper over, like, a Banksy, like a print.
No, that's just copying. Okay. That's just copying. All right, let's get off of artsy-fartsy shit for a second and get into a little bit of fuck shit. The only reason why I say fuck shit because we're talking about Kanye West. And, We know that what's been going on lately, so we don't want to get into all the shit that's already been regurgitated as far as
I ain't trying to have no more conversations.
Whatever thing. We're not talking about. We've heard it all before. But anyway, you say he's dropping a new album, right? What's the date?
The 28th, next Friday.
Okay, so he's been pretty consistent with the date, so there's no reason why we shouldn't get that.
Now, what time is going to come out? Now, that's completely different.
No. Probably 4 in the morning. But I'm looking forward to the listening party, though. See, I'm not like a lot of you motherfuckers. I'm not fake mad at Kanye West.
I'm not fake mad.
Nah, you kind of fake mad at him a little bit.
You know what it is?
You fake done.
I'm not even fake done.
I'm going to tell you why you fake done.
All right.
Because you have done... But you the nigga that be right there with me, 12 midnight.
Yeah, because I'm going to check it out. I'm a music fan. Like, I love music.
Nah, but if you done with him, you're not even... This motherfucker hadn't even listened to the album yet. The last album. Because they was done.
I listened to Ye because I was interested because I was just confused. Because everything to me with Kanye, especially with him and the Kardashian family, everything's a publicity stunt to me.
Okay.
Once you got Kris Jenner in your corner, I think everything's getting flipped. There's no way, other way to flip it. Like, she's like a flip queen.
Yeah, well, let's reel it in. So, we wanted to talk about the album, right?
Okay.
So, it's supposed to be...
It's like YANDHI?
YANDHI.
Which is like a playoff Gandhi?
Yeah. So, people are thinking Yeezus, and it's supposed to be like a sequel to that.
I mean, I looked at the cover, and like, it's the same place. Like CD, but it's just a purple tape.
Okay. Oh, that's dope. Is that a nod to Raekwon's purple tape?
I would see it as Kanye.
Just maybe a hip hop nostalgia thing.
Don't matter what with Kanye, he's still a hip hop head.
Yeah.
So I can see that probably being like him, like giving that nod.
So what are we feeling about it? What are you excited?
See, now here's my thing. I got two different areas of it. Now, I'm one of the few people that love Yeezus. I love
Yeezus' album. But I love every Kanye album.
Even 808s?
Of course, especially 808s.
A lot of people don't like 808s, so I love 808s. Like, if we ranking Kanye, especially. I was 808s is my number one.
That's your number one? But you're a real emo.
I am an emo.
That sounds about right.
So it works. But
damn, number one?
Uh-huh. For creativity.
Over Graduation and over...
I don't even have Graduation in my top three.
College Dropout?
have College Dropout and Late Registration.
We're going on a tangent, but how did College Dropout age being the first album?
It aged pretty well.
When's the last time you listened to it? Let's keep it on.
Like a couple months ago. I would say it's not something I'm listening to a lot. Late Registration aged well. Late registration aged really well.
So what you're saying, College Dropout didn't?
Not as well as Late Registration.
Okay.
There's certain songs that still work great there, like Family Affair, maybe. Jesus Walks is still gets played no matter what. Two words, but it didn't age as well as Late Registration. I think everything on Late Registration is still great to today.
Yeah.
But
I agree.
When it comes down to the young, I love Yeezus. And I don't want this. Like, if this is a separate project, cool. But the idea of Yeezus is more rebellion. Like, when I think of Yeezus, it was super rebellious.
Okay.
Like, when I think of it, it just had, like, that vengeful, evil, you know, that just revenge tone. So
because
like,
of the, you said that because of the production?
The production was more darker. So it's like, all right, this is YANDHI.
Black skinheads, definitely.
Yeah. Blood in the Leaves, the drums on that.
My favorite joint is, when he had the projection on the building.
New Slaves.
New Slaves.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was definitely
yeah,
my...
even the drums and the
yeah,
sounds
New Slaves
that.
Is my
so
is
it's
my
like,
favorite.
If you think, if I'm thinking YANDHI, or and that's a playoff of Gandhi, I'm like, what tone am I about to get?
But I wouldn't expect him to follow the same direction.
No.
Just because that was, 2013?
Yeah.
And he's just, who knows? But I just, so...
At the same point, but I don't get what I get or I want from Kanye anymore.
You don't?
No.
So you didn't get that from Ye?
No. Well, I want from... Well,
did you
I've
like
always,
Ye?
It was okay.
Okay.
It was okay.
What is it, last on your list for Kanye albums?
Yeah. It'll be last. Okay. It'll be second to last. So, no, it'll be last.
Okay.
Yeah. It'd be last because.
So then your expectations are good because you didn't like that album. So
no, so like,
this is just a little
room
better
to
than that.
Grow to yeah. be higher than Ye, but my thing for this, with Kanye is when I used to come for Kanye, it was like experimental production and it was lyrics. I'm not gonna lie, one part I really did come from for lyrics.
Mm-hmm.
From Yeezus, I haven't gotten that.
you didn't get any lyrics on Pablo?
What? No More Parties in L.A. That was it.
Yeah, I really liked, not that it was so lyrical, I really liked, what was it, 30 Hours?
Yeah, 30 Hours was cool. I like 30, there were certain songs that, yeah, I got it, but I was looking for, I used to get that whole thing for a whole album from him. You get what I'm saying?
Yeah, you know what it is with me? I have to admit, now, everybody has this with certain artists. Kanye, he almost could do no wrong to me. Like, to me, I kind of accept him just kind of to get creative for me. He's that one artist to me. I really do like every album. I'm not going to front. Like, I do like every album.
I have that artist. If I do, the closest would be Kendrick.
Where, like, he could do no wrong?
I've never heard a bad Kendrick project.
Okay, and I agree, too.
From, like, Section 80 till now, every project
And not to get on a tangent, because we can talk about that another
time.
But I will say, you know, there is a big population that really don't rock with Butterfly, to Pimp a Butterfly like that.
We not going to, yeah.
But I'm saying, I mean, they like it, but
they
can't go back to it as much. You know what I'm saying?
That's like,
for them.
I consistently go back to
it. I got
it,
you. But that's
like the same thing like how we just said with 808s.
There's a
lot of people that don't rock with 808s.
Yeah,
there's a lot of people that don't rock with Yeezus. And they're like, oh, it's cool, but it's not something I go to.
Gotcha.
And that's the way I look at to Pimp a Butterfly. It's polarizing in that same vein. I can't even say Cuddy. Cuddy was one, but no, I can't. Like, there's same song album. There's an album.
And he's done a lot of wrong, so you can't say he does no wrong.
Speeding Bullet to Heaven. So.
Yeah.
But yeah, Kanye's lost that with me. Like, I'm kind of like the cynical Kanye fan a little bit.
All right, so I would just say in a nutshell, you don't really have high expectations for this new album.
I'm expecting two good tracks at least. If I get more than two good tracks that I can go back to, I'd say it's a success.
And I'm expecting a dope album, to be honest with you. I'm expecting it to be creative. I'm expecting. I think he's in an interesting space. I think it's like it's weird. I think with
he's
Kanye,
Brandon.
But with Kanye, right? If you notice, right? So think about when he first came out. I don't know how old he was when he first came out, like late 20s, something
late
like 20s, that.
Almost 30s.
All right, so I feel like he was more talking about like more mature shit then. It's almost like he's content-wise, as far as maturity,
it's regressed.
It's going regressed. But I do like the fuck shit that he does too. Like, you don't like the shit with Lil Pump?
I'm not gonna lie. The first time I heard it, I hated it. But I'm not gonna lie that I'm a sick fuck. I need the, like, damn, it got. He does shit. Even when I'm not a fan of it, he does shit that gets stuck in my head.
Exactly.
And I can't help it. The ecstasy.
You don't like ecstasy, right? Nah, ecstasy is dope. Why don't you like it? You don't like the beat.
I don't like the beat. The content.
It's too avant-garde. It's too abstract.
Yeah, it's too much. It's too much. Like, I like abstract shit, but it's just not for me.
And you hated what was the shit that he dropped? It wasn't on the album.
Oh, Scoop the Deep.
Yeah.
Oh, get that shit off.
But that beat.
Oh,
but
listen,
the beat.
That's the shit that got me so mad, because the beat was so dope, and I'm just waiting for it. Then I hear Scoop the Deep. I'm like, nope.
Classic fucking Kanye beat.
Oh, it's a classic Kanye beat.
But he's brought the Scoop Diddy Poop out a couple of times since.
I know, but still. Like, okay, like, here's my thing. If he could give me two to three tracks on this that I like, and I know he said he's doing a project with Chance. If that, which is touchy, because
Bronx Dog, by the way, not to cut you off if you're here in the back.
But the fact he named a good-ass job for old Kanye fans, that's like a touchy subject.
What's the album coming first? The solo?
The solo one comes next week. And then after that, him and Chance are working on good ass.
No date? They just working on it?
They didn't say when, but they said they're working on it. And he put up videos of him.
We'll see when that comes.
Yeah, but the fact that his name, Good Ass Job, which is supposed to be the follow-up.
Let's see. I don't know. I believe that when it comes for some reason.
Yeah, I feel like he just plays with people.
Yeah.
He just has fun doing that.
If he said he's dropping an album, it feels like he's dropping an album.
Yeah.
Because recently he kind of. He
been
come
more
out
in the public eye.
And also he came out. Was that yesterday that he did it? Or the day before? With the Instagram.
Oh,
announcement to Nick Cannon and
that was all last yesterday.
What was it? Nick Cannon and
Nick Cannon, Drake, and Tyson Bedford.
Oh yeah, what did Tyson Bedford do?
I don't even know about Tyson Bedford.
What did he hop out of a time machine?
I thought he came out the casket. I don't even know. Like,
he actually was in Art Basel this year with us, not with us, but there was a sighting. Yeah, they saw him.
Oh shit! Maybe.
I heard a couple people was groupie-ish too that was with us. We ain't gonna blow them up. But
I haven't heard somebody go crazy for Tyson Beckford in a long time. The only thing I had dreads when somebody was going crazy for him. So
since
I don't know.
2002.
I think the Drake shit was real reaching when he was talking about that. Who? I was like, Kanye, but he was like, you ain't really saying that. Well, I'm like, Drake ain't done no interviews. So
no, but he's like, don't if it's. He just wanted him to go on record and say, no, that didn't happen. I didn't fuck Kanye. I didn't fuck Kim Kardashian. But Drake's not gonna do it. He's gonna let it linger.
Of course. That's Drake.
Yeah.
That's Drake's MO. He lets shit linger. It keeps his name bubbling. Keeps him while he's just doing his tour, making his money.
So Kanye want that smoke? What is he back in Chicago?
No, he don't want no. No. Let's be honest. Kanye's not.
He's under the L train and shit.
For real. Kanye's at the point right now where I think lyrically he wouldn't go against nobody. But I think at the point where Kanye's just like, he's just gonna express whatever the hell he feels. And I think he feels some way about the whole allegation. Cause Nick Cannon's the person who started the allegation.
Was he?
Yeah, cause he started on Everyday Struggle. And he did an episode.
I remember that, but that wasn't the first time you heard that.
Well, somebody said, I think Academic said it, and he was like, hey, that's not impossible.
But Academic's been saying that.
Yeah, Academic say a lot of shit. But at the same point, it's just like, bro, Drake's not going to acknowledge that. Drake's not going to say nothing about it.
Well, what do you think about it?
I don't really. Do I think it's possible? I don't know.
I don't think he did.
No. Drake got too much. Also, Drake got too much other drama coming off. He's damn near looking like a pedophile out here.
Pedophile?
You ain't hear about him with the 18-year-old actress? Like, going to dinner.
Yeah. I did hear that.
So I'm like, he got too much women smoke already going on around. He got too much.
This makes me sound bad, but she's 18. It's not like she's 16. She's young. It's bad. I get it, but.
I mean, he's like 31. It's like,
I know. I sound dead wrong for saying that. But I'm just saying, whatever.
Hey.
It happens. You think he's the only one out there?
No. Hell no. I know that. But it's just the fact, like, you're the biggest pop star.
Yeah.
You should know how this is going to get viewed.
How old is Drake now?
Like 31? Almost 30, 31?
He's like famous 25.
Yeah. His fame is
You know, you don't grow up in a regular game.
Yeah. Especially when you hit that, like, he got that longevity fame, so it's a little different.
So listen, let's get into some shit you mentioned to me the other day, which I don't think people are that familiar. But we know of the term ghostwriters as far as, like, rappers and shit. That's the new thing. Rappers have ghostwriters and shit.
I mean, that's not new.
Well, no, not new, rap, but you know. Yeah. It's, well, it's kind of new as far as hip hop because that wasn't like a cool thing.
No.
But it's more common now to hear the term. That really wasn't a common term in 97. Yeah, exactly. Even if it was going on, it wasn't a thing.
Oh, we devoted to secrecy the whole eye this secret.
But that's not, we don't want to talk about that. We want to talk about another term called ghost artists.
Yeah.
Now, what's that about?
So there are artists out here who have made thousands, hundreds of thousands on their work, but they're not really the creators of the work. There's another artist in the background that has designed the work and really sent it to them, and they do it.
Okay.
The first artist I met that was...
Wait. So they're not... But the other person, they know they're not getting the credit for it.
Yeah.
So they're getting paid for it.
So here's the thing. Some people, if they're not paying attention to art shit, you're not paying attention to art, so you don't know how much somebody really selling their pieces for.
Mm-hmm.
You just know that they selling work.
Okay.
There's an artist on Instagram. His name is Mike Mozart. I met Mike Mozart like 3 years ago, and I met him at an event he did in the Lower East Side. Really dope artist, older dude, and I guess he was doing artists for a big artist, I'm not gonna say any name, but he showed the text messages, he put it all on Instagram, everything, that he was the ghost artist.
Okay.
Mind you, this artist was doing $1 million brand deals, but he's...
So he blew it up, you're saying?
Yeah, he blew it up.
But why?
He blew it up because... when he first met the guy, that was before the guy blew up. When he first met the big artist, it was before the big artist blew up. And the big artist never really paid him. He was just like, yo, can you help me with this? And then when he would give him whatever, he was really saying like, oh, I'm only selling it for this much. Like, he was underpaying him, like literally telling him like, oh, it was under this amount.
But so wait, I just want to get a clear understanding. So somebody comes to an artist and says,
yeah, like an artist that was like,
I need you to paint some shit for me.
It's not paint. It's like really sending the stencil. Like, it's kind of like sending the sketch. Like, say something.
Of the painting.
Yeah.
So the idea of what the painting's going to be?
Right.
And then the other artist fills it out?
Mm-hmm. This artist, because he explained the process. This artist would put it on a projector onto the canvas.
Oh, okay.
And then paint it.
So what is that agreement, though? So for you to do that with a person, you thinking that you're getting compensated with...
There ain't no contract on that. That's y'all going to have to figure that out. You know what I'm saying? That's like a verbal thing.
See, ghosts, right? It doesn't work the same. Like, no. Ghosts writing the music, there's a purpose. Because at the end of the day, there's, in music, besides hip-hop, there's always a writer and a performer.
R&B.
But as far as art is concerned, I don't see the purpose of somebody... Art is about literally just personal expression. Unless you're calling it a collaboration.
No, this person.
No, yeah, yeah, no. But for somebody to ghostwrite, there's nothing to gain from that. Mm-hmm. At the end of the day, it's just a fraud. That's really just a fraud. That's fraudulent. When painting and art is concerned.
This is big name artist has a whole plethora of ghost artists.
You saying big name artists that are out there right now? Yeah, we're not saying names,
but artist who he has multiple ghost artists.
Okay. Are you saying one somebody specific? But do you think are there a lot of artists that are doing that?
I think there possibly is.
Like, fuck it. Artists like, who's a good example? Like, really big. I mean, somebody like Banksy is too big.
Nah.
Yes.
I wouldn't say someone like a King Saladin. I wouldn't say he's like, he has ghost artists.
No. Somebody bigger than that. Like, who would you say is bigger than that? What's the shit? Oh man, why can't you think of this guy's name?
Which one?
This shit is in Wynwood. He's not as big as Banksy, but...
Oh, he got the portrait... Oh God, why can't I not remember his name? Ron English?
No.
Who?
This is dumb once we're forgetting. Because once I say it, it's going to be so obvious. I'm having a fucking brain fart right now.
But I got a question. In regards to, like, you see some artists and they have like 4 or 5 people working on a painting. And they have 4 or 5 people working on a painting. Do those 4 or 5 people, do they count as ghost artists? Because you know they'd be these people that be working on these like 7-8 foot long paintings.
No. That's like a mural, you mean?
Yeah.
No. And that's funny you say that because I got a fuck on a mural and I wanted to have somebody, I wanted to have Christy help me like paint. Mm-hmm. And I got to ask about that. Is that acceptable? I think murals are okay for you to color. Nah. Christy's saying, you could talk, Christy. It's all right. Christy's in the background. Right. No, Mr. Brainwash, he doesn't count because we know he has people doing this shit. That's different. No, fucking, now I have to think about it. Stephen Ferry? No. Yeah, right?
Yeah.
What's his name? Obey.
Oh.
That's like somebody like him. Does he have ghost artists?
I don't think so. That's more street. Like, his stuff is more stencilized.
Okay,
so
right,
I don't
so,
even
okay,
feel like
okay,
his stuff
okay. Is I got really, you, I got you. I
yeah.
Got you.
But I mean, like, you claiming that you're creating the real art, but you have other people, you know, really drawing it because you can't really draw the stuff.
At all? Or just because you...
You can't do it as well. So you get people that are more skilled. And you got the money. Well, I'm going to pay you.
Chrissy, what are you mouthing me? I don't know what you're... What are you saying?
I'm shaking my
head. Oh.
But it's like, there are artists who, like, this person basically, he has, like, 2-3 other ghost artists that will draw his stuff.
I don't know. I just feel like music is one thing. I don't think it's... You know what I mean? You could say, if you want to talk the whole MC right. shit, then you... You can't go somebody MC, but it's fine as far as making music.
Entertainment is like,
what? But making art, if it's not a collaboration where everybody's getting credited, to me that's just fraudulent.
But I think that comes to the part where we talked about before, where it's like certain people do shit for the money. Like when you start making a certain amount of money, does that take the whole idea of like the merit in your art out of it because the profit comes?
Yeah.
And I feel like that's a part where someone loses the artist. Yeah. At a point, you just an entertainer.
Pretty much.
You just an entertainer with a paintbrush.
Oh, you're just a face.
Pretty much.
Because I don't know, even entertainers loose. You didn't do anything.
Right. But at this point,
you're a presenter.
Like, yeah, pretty much. You just like, you just a connection to this.
Yeah.
Like, you're no longer.
It's stupid. It's just fraudulent.
It is fraudulent, yeah, but you know what? There are people that are paying this person millions for this. Yeah. Like, not realizing that this
is. It's Milli Vanilli.
Super Milli Vanilli.
Is that I don't know, anybody who's like a fucking, who was born in 98 or some shit like that, who's watching, go Google Milli Vanilli.
Mm-hmm.
But if you're an 80s baby, 90, early 90s baby, then you know what we're talking about. But that's some Milli Vanilli shit.
Yeah. And there's a lot of this shit going on. And there's artists who don't even come up with their own ideas. That's another question. If an artist takes another artist's idea, like bites another artist's idea.
But that's just being a thief. Which is, I mean,
I feel like, you know, artists, if you gotta take somebody else's idea and run with it.
I mean, you are still, all right, like, even, like, Picasso stole shit from people.
Yeah.
So at the end of the day, I mean, big time artists do, I mean, I don't know his quote off the back, but he had a quote about theft and artist theft and shit. But, so at the end of the day, he was still a fucking artist. He just was a thief in the moment. The other day, I was thinking of a crazy, crazy thought.
Oh shit.
You might want to call it, I don't know, some might call it a theory.
Okay.
I wouldn't even say a theory, that's too deep. But just a deep thought.
Okay.
Maybe someone call it a hot take, but I think it's more just a deep thought.
What's the hot take?
So check it out. If James Brown, right?
Okay.
Hold on. Let me back it up before I say that.
Okay.
So you know we're in an era of what people call mumble rap?
Yeah.
A lot of purists hate it and shit like that.
Right.
And some of it sucks, but some of it is good too, I think.
Right.
But it got me thinking, music and how it evolves and basically that's the Bronx dog in the back. If y'all hear that, that's just what it is. That's how we do it on the Fantasy Brother podcast. But yeah, it got me thinking. People always. When it's the next generation, it's like they get so disconnected from it, but they liked it when it was their generation. And it got me thinking, this might be risque, but tell me what you think. James Brown was a mumble rapper. He was. If you think about it.
Okay, you're going to break this down.
If James Brown was fucking 19 in modern times or whatever age he was, I mean, he was young. He would have been a mumble rapper, and this is my reason why.
So?
I'm gonna tell you why. I'm not even gonna stop the obvious. I'll save the obvious.
Okay.
One, I'll express. And let's give a little fucking music lesson for those who don't know. But James Brown did funk music, which was definitely about the feel and the vibe. It wasn't like classical music where it was like a million notes. It was a simple kind of funk, but it was just fucking, it was feel. It was all feel. And the obvious point, who the fuck knew what James Brown was saying at the time? You shitting me, dude? You don't fucking know James Brown lyrics. You know how shit sounds. And it's a vibe. And you're perfectly fine with that. You've gotten through your whole life not knowing every word James Brown was saying. You know some. But when he really got into it, his shit. And so what's the difference of these mumble rappers? Like, it's the same thing. It was more vibe. And listen, say what you want about. Okay, let's break it down. And right. You're younger than me, so right. You're forced to be the. You're not 19.
No.
But you're forced to be the.
The younger voice.
The toucher. Yeah. A little more in touch. Even though I know my shit too.
Right.
But who is good mumble rap?
So I always thought the term mumble rap was bullshit.
But
if we're looking at good, I'll probably say Thug. I'll say Uzi.
Okay, so Uzi. All right.
Thug and Uzi.
Okay, so let's leave it at that, those two. Perfect.
Yeah.
Now. Here's my argument. Mm-hmm. You don't see the similarities in vibe, funk, feeling, expression through sound, but like through grunts and moans and sound deflections.
Okay.
And here and there catching words and there not catching fucking words.
As a young Thug fan, I could definitely say with Thug, I could see that a lot.
Okay.
Uzi even sometimes. But I think, even though I could get what you're saying,
okay,
what I would say is the difference is there's still certain songs I can definitely know James Brown's lyrics more than I could know Thug's and stuff and other mumble rappers. But I feel like there's a good chunk. I feel like the majority. I might be wrong, but I'm saying the majority. Because here's the thing. Like,
we doing this shit raw. We don't know the FCA rules.
We're about
to play some James Brown on this podcast.
Listen, I'm the type of person, I go on the Young Thug's concerts. I know Young Thug's lyrics, and I know there's a lot of shit sometimes. I be confused on what the fuck you say, but I love it.
It did. It even keep it there. That's some James Brown shit, nigga. That's what he said.
Don't get me wrong. I understand he kind of gave that like scat feel. That people like Michael Jackson kind of incorporate in their music.
Exactly.
That feel has always been in music. That's why I just never thought, like, mumble, I never thought it was mumble. I thought it was just more like people just wasn't catching what they were saying.
No, you didn't use the word mumble then, but that's what I'm saying. I'm bringing
it. Even today still.
I'm bringing it full circle. So I'm saying, it's shocking to say James Brown's a mumble rapper. I'm saying if James Brown
would he be classified as mumble
young
rapper
today and he was making music with the vibe he had,
he'd be seen as a mumble rapper.
And the energy he had, wouldn't he have made mumble rap in a sense? Like,
people would see him as a mumble rapper. I would say he's not a mumble rapper though,
because it's melody.
Yeah,
but it's not. I mean, what the fuck was he saying? Let me see something. Where should we go? Should I go with number one on the top tracks?
Yeah, let's go with that.
I don't want to look bad because I think I know the lyrics to that, but let's see if he sounds clear or not. I know we breaking some type of fucking.
Something's gonna happen. It'll be alright. I need some get back. Okay, I didn't know what the fuck he just said right there. I didn't know what he said before. Payback.
And I actually did hear it, but I know the words. But it's not that clear, nigga. It's just a vibe. Now, the old head's gonna be like, no, we know what the fuck he's saying. Yeah, because he's been listening to the song for 40 fucking years.
Of course, they got time to decipher that shit. That's the end of 50 years. But, hold on.
It feels like we should turn that off, but I don't know if that made the point. I'm sure there's some other shit that's way unclear.
I can understand what you're saying, because there's not a lot of shit that's.
Let's do one.
The energy that he gave.
Let's do one more.
Come on, this one, you can hear everything.
We breaking all of the fucking rules. This is going to SoundCloud right now. We good. I knew that I would not. So good. So good. I got to hear. Yeah, we can hear him now.
Okay. Yeah, I bet a question to pose to you. One thing that gets heaped on a lot with this music is the fact that there's not a lot of There's not, it's like, it's very, they say it's like very light toned. There's not a lot depth into it.
Content wise?
Yeah, content wise. I feel like a lot of music is, even with James Brown, it didn't have to be heavily content. You understood what it felt in that time. And it was like, within that time, you got that feeling. Like, I feel good. It doesn't really have to be deep, but everybody resonated with it.
Yeah.
At that
yeah, but these young niggas resonate with fucking...
But they resonate with the people. Edge.
Oh, right. My friends are dead.
They resonate with the people of today. So it's like, it doesn't have to be deep.
Yeah, but not all of James Brown shit was deep either.
No, but that's what I'm saying. Like, sometimes shit can
be deep. But a lot of it was too, though. Yeah. Let's not be...
But a lot of shit can be deep, but a lot of shit can't. And I feel like people just think that because they just... You can't hear everything clearly, that is just mumbling and senseless.
To recap, I have one more James Brown selection. Just like I said, I'm sure we're not supposed to be playing fucking shit.
This episode.
But shout out to fucking, shout out the title, nigga. Shout out the title, nigga. We're doing it for the art culture. All right, so here we go. Let's do it. Man, like a legend. A woman out there.
See, this goes with my whole thing. Like, it doesn't have to be ultra deep.
But a lot of people, but it's mumbleless.
It is mumbleless.
Machine.
I question if James Brown made a whole complete positive sentence that didn't sound like he mumbled through it.
Nah.
Man, he's drunk out.
Fun fact, James Brown used to beat the shit out of his wife too. I didn't know that until I saw the movie.
But that's the shit about
the
it.
The movie blew it up. It's a random,
fucked
not,
up song.
Yeah, not incorporated, but I mean, no. not associated with that. But mm-mm. But yeah, that's my theory. Cool, so I mean, yeah. So you don't really agree with me, but you see my points.
I understand your point, but I wouldn't agree.
All right, he wouldn't be a mumble rapper. I don't know. I just think that.
But I feel like a lot of shit, if you can't hear it nowadays, they label it as mumble rap.
Who's not mumble rap that they say is mumble rap? Was like X was X mumble rap? Nah.
People said that 21.
But he wasn't mumble. But no, XXX.
A lot of people label him as mumble rap, but I don't understand how.
He just had the mumble rap look. Because here's another thing. There's a mumble rap look.
There's a mumble rap look.
Color dreads.
And I was a person who tattoos. Liked X. He had color dreads, face tattoos. And he had like that crazy energy. So they just instantly thought, oh, here's
another 6ix9ine mumble rap?
No, he's fucking anxiety rap. That's what I call 6ix9ine.
Anxiety rap? What do you mean?
Like, when I hear his music, my anxiety goes up. Okay. It sounds
not
like,
me. I want to punch somebody in the face.
But that's why I feel like a fight's about to break out, and he's saying, like, damn, nigga. Like, I don't have the energy for that.
But you got to hear shit in the right settings. Like,
oh, no.
You don't want to hear him 7:30 in the morning on the way to work.
Like, I can listen to 6ix9ine going to the gym. Like, yeah. That's my gym. Like, I can listen to that going to the gym. I can't.
But I also think he's at a club. I don't even like going to clubs, but I think he's at a party. Mm-hmm. There's a party you like. It doesn't have to be like a club, but just a dope party with his music and dancing. It could be a nice vibe.
I don't know about that.
At fucking almost the end of the night, almost end of the party, you have full drunk or whatever the mode you're in, and that should come on. Yeah, that should get
I'll
you
I'll give
fucking,
you Fifi with him and Nikki for that, but I don't want
to. So you like Fifi? You wanted to hate on it at first, right? Oh, you don't like it?
I actually like it.
No. And when I first saw it, I wanted to hate everything about it, like the video.
The video, I definitely don't like the video. But the song,
the song is dope.
It's okay.
The song,
but like I can hear Fifi in the club, and I probably wouldn't be mad. But the other song, like what's that joint he got, Billy? I can't hear Billy in the club.
Now the fucked up shit is, I like his songs, and I know him by watching all the videos. But like only one, I don't remember was Billy or fucking. Fifi or
Billy's the one where just like in the chorus, like everybody getting shot.
So that's my shit right there, though.
I can't hear that in the club.
And what's the What's the other shit that that PA did the beat?
Oh,
that's my shit too.
That's
like, hey,
Sticky with the flicky. I can't hear that shit either in the club. I get like
that shit just feels good.
I feel like fucking feels ignorant. I feel like Def Jam Vendetta about to break out.
It makes me reminisce on all the ignorant shit I've done in my life, but like I don't do shit like that anymore. But it's just like. You know what I mean? It takes you back to a time.
Yeah. Actually,
what's the most ignorant shit you ever did? Like foul shit that you probably don't even want to say on the podcast right now. Like being young and just rebellious. I know mine. It's real fucked up too, but I'll let you go first.
Shit, I got a couple of them. Fuck.
Want me to say mine's first?
Yeah, you go ahead.
Nah, mine's fucked up. Why did I bring this up?
I mean, I could go first. Mine isn't like fucked up. Like, I'm petty.
This is not even on topic of shit we're supposed to be talking about.
I'm super petty. So it's like, my mom's ex-boyfriend, he ate my birthday cake one time before I got home for my birthday.
Okay.
So he used to be healthy into like the teas and shit. I switched all his teas for laxative teas.
Oh, he was a citizen. He could have murdered that nigga. He could have died.
Don't fuck with my shit. Oh,
I didn't even know you was going mom's boyfriends. I used to throw fucking batteries at my mom's boyfriend.
See, but that was like during my reckless time. Next to that, I don't know. Like, I've just randomly ran up on people and just.
I ain't like. So you had a was your mom's boyfriend like your nemesis and shit?
My mom knows this. She probably gonna be listening to this. This. Like, me and that nigga did not rock.
My mom's probably gonna listen to this, but I definitely didn't fuck with that nigga. That one particular nigga. I probably slapped the shit out of that nigga. But nah. What's the fucking what's next in the joint? Let me see. Oh yeah, so we did the. Oh yeah, so we got that was my hot take on James Brown. It's just a thought. Fuck it, it's a wild thought.
I will say this.
Wild thoughts.
Instantly getting thrown in there because of that. I see people throwing him into that mumble rap shit.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. I got you. So let's talk about what's up? Shout out to the motherfucking Bronx dog outside.
Mm-hmm. Consistent with
if
that
y'all,
part.
If y'all do, hopefully y'all hear it because we mentioned him so much. But anyway, let's talk about the hustle of art.
Yeah.
So people see that people, you know, there's a lot of artists out here and post their shit on Instagram. But, you know, what else does it take to go? What does it go into being an artist? Is that what it takes? How do we make money? People don't see what it is, how we survive and make a living off what it is that we create.
Yeah.
Which there are a lot of different ways. Number one being actually selling paintings.
That's like the number one.
That's the number one.
I think if every artist had it their way, they would sell a whole bunch of paintings every day. Yeah. An artist would sell a painting a day.
But realistically, that's not how it works.
Nah.
So we gotta have a bunch more. I mean, like, I think everybody has their own thing. So I'll let you explain. Like, what is your art hustle? Like, I'll explain mine.
Right now, it's the merchandise game. Like, I'm trying to get into that. Doing pins, doing stickers, doing prints. Trying to do t-shirts and clothing, because that's where it's at. Because sometimes not everybody's going to have the money to buy a $200-$300 painting. Okay. But somebody might have $10 to buy a pen. Somebody might have the $10-$15 to buy a print. Somebody might put down $30 for a shirt.
Mm-hmm.
And the thing about it is, even with that, you still have the painting not losing any of its prestige right there and not taking away from it. But at the same time, I'm giving you something you can wear, and then from you wearing it, maybe somebody else see it, they want to get it. Then, you know, it's like a snowball effect.
And what else do you think that when it comes to like making actual money from your art, what is it? Or is there anything that you feel like you're not doing that you feel like you could be doing?
I mean, for me, honestly, when it comes down to being an artist and hustling, the one thing I've learned mostly is sometimes you gotta sit back and learn. A lot of people nowadays, they don't wanna sit back and learn. It's like, I need the money now. And it's like, art ain't something where you gonna get all the bread instantly.
Mm-mm,
you gotta be okay understanding that you might have to sit down for a little period and there might not be no bread coming in for a little bit.
Yeah.
And a lot of people's not comfortable with that. And it's like, this ain't get rich quick. This isn't like,
no, not at all.
This ain't nothing like that. This ain't like wake up now. This ain't nothing like that. Like, this is something where it's gonna take time.
Yeah.
I think for me, the most thing recently, like, I fell back on the advertising side, because advertising yourself and marketing yourself,
that's, you mean like on social media?
Yeah, I fell back a little bit just because I was dealing with my own shit. But I feel like people gotta also learn to market yourself.
Yeah.
Marketing yourself is a major thing. But don't market yourself into a corner where now you gotta be this perfect person. Like, market who the fuck you really are. Because the thing is, you wanna build up a whole catalog of people that really fuck with you because they see who the fuck you really are.
Who you are.
Because when the cracks, if you give them like this character, when the cracks of who you really are start to show, they're gonna be like, oh, I want this shit.
Exactly.
So it's like, be who the fuck you really are. At the same time, create shit that you know you can sell. And at the same time, understand, like, don't cut down your art.
I think for me, it's like, like almost everything, I think it's about being consistent. I think like if you wanna make money off paintings, that's then you gotta constantly be pushing out work so that people just, you know, get familiar with you. And and it's a slow grind, and the biggest thing about it is just unpredictable no matter what. It's gonna always be unpredictable.
And you gotta know what seasons you're working in.
Yeah.
Summertime is not the best time to start selling a whole bunch of art.
It's not. If you're lucky, like, sometimes if you're lucky, you'll sell one or two, and then that's good. But I think the biggest thing is just being consistent. I think a lot of artists sometimes, they're seasonal with it. Like, they have moments when they're into it, and they take, I mean, we get it, people go through shit, but I mean, if you're making that choice to actually be an artist, like, you kind of, like, you can't take for so much of a hiatus from this shit.
Exactly.
This is what it is you do. I mean, you might be able to get your... I mean, and also, some of us are, like, creative in many different ways. So, like, okay, let's say maybe, like, some people paint, but they have another form of expression. Even if maybe you need to take a break off that painting, but you got to be doing something. You can't just take a... You can't just take a fall off. Exactly. Where you just not even creative shit. Motherfucker, go fucking... You better go crochet or do something creative, motherfucker. You just to get an idea. But I think that's what it is.
Also, like, oversaturating. Just because something hitting now, don't mean you're going to have to keep, like, doing it. Like, don't keep flooding the market. Sometimes let stuff go, let it make its run, and then come back.
But you also hit on something good when you said merch. I think that's the biggest hustle for artists in this era, because you said sometimes everybody... I mean, I don't know... I don't think the world, I mean, we love art, obviously, but I don't think we purchase paintings the way we did, like, I mean, like, just say, in the fucking 50s or the 60s, I think we probably purchased art differently. It was a higher media then.
Yeah, it was a higher desire.
Exactly, and to have it, but now it's just so many, I mean, you could just get art so many different ways, visually, you don't have to really own it.
You know what that also is? I think that's the generation we live in. The generation we live in right now is so quick to instantly receive, no one's going to sit down on a piece of art for like 10, 20 years. So it's weirder for people to like own something for like maybe majority of their life and really see the worth of it. And it's like, that's really how art is supposed to be consumed, is that it's like 20, 30, 40, 50 years of like you owning this, and then like the real worth of it is shown.
Yeah.
So it's like people can't do that. So sometimes it's like, well... Let me give you another version of this, a quicker version, almost like the fast food of it. I give you the merchandise.
Yeah.
I give you the shirts. I give you the hoodies. I give you the sweaters.
I think that's where it's at, though.
Yeah, right now, I think the merchandising and doing original pieces and clothing and selling it is pretty much what's hot. Because the thing is, fashion's really, you know, that's where everybody's attention is fashion. So if you can find a way
to capitalize. And you got to know your audience. Like, at the end of the day, I came to the understanding that I've been fortunate enough to sell a good amount of paintings for the amount of time that I've been painting. And then I analyze, okay, who's really buying my art? And I would say it is people of a certain age. So at the end of the day, I know those people aren't necessarily people with the biggest incomes at this moment. That doesn't mean they won't be, but I've had a lot of people, like I would say, in their 20s and 30s purchase art from me. That was the most. You know what I'm saying? So my biggest fan base of people that are purchasing art aren't like in their 50s where they can fucking drop a G like it's nothing or 2-3 G's on a painting because they have it like that. So realistically, I have to make art tailored for the people that could afford my shit. So maybe like right now, I'm not gonna do the hugest painting that I know I have to sell for a big amount of money because my biggest fan base right now maybe can't afford that. So I'm gonna make shit that I know that I can sell. So I'm not just sitting on art because I'm not making art to sit on it for fucking 3 years until somebody could afford to pay for it. So I'd rather make shit. That's what it is right now.
And I think going with that, you have to do these events, like when you go to like somewhere like a Miami for Art Basel, you have to do these things. But you have to go there not expecting for the financial income, but for the connections that can lead to the greater financial income. Because here's the thing, as an artist, if you're trying to make the money, sometimes painting smaller is for quicker cash. But if you're an artist who really needs to like get themselves out on like a giant canvas, understand you might want to make the connections first that might lead you to the people that buy these big canvases.
Exactly.
So when you go to somewhere like a Miami, don't go like you've already accomplished a lot of shit and like you have this overly cocky personality. Because no one's going to want to fuck with you.
Exactly.
Because they're going to be like, motherfucker, I move Picasso pieces. who the fuck are you? You just coming to me off the corner. So it's like, come through with that humility, meet these people, bring some of your best work, get the connections. I think a lot of the major part of the hustle that gets lost is the fucking connections. People so sometimes be like, I created this, I'm so dope. No one gives a fuck.
Like, exactly.
No one gives a fuck about how dope you feel. If you ain't meeting the right people and getting shit in the right places, and you ain't creating shit that's like creating that constant revenue, you could be the greatest motherfucker walking this earth artistically. But if your business sense ain't shit, no one cares.
Yeah.
And the fact is, like, I love to create, but I also understand it's a business. I understand that this shit's a business. I understand for, I want to do a big art gallery doing big pieces. But I know at the same point, for me to get people in there that's going to buy that shit, I might need to go conversate with a bunch of people. I got to do that footwork. A lot of people don't realize that footwork is super important. Like, yeah, that footwork is like the biggest whole aspect of everything. And
shaking hands and kissing babies.
Right. And people be like, oh, no, I ain't got to do this. I ain't got to do that. No, you got to. Like, this footwork, like, you are your spokesperson.
But then that's the other thing, too. Because artists are weirdos, so we see why that's a big deal. But
yeah,
I mean, this is a broad topic. I think we'll even revisit this once we have, like, some other artists around, too. Because I would like to see how other artists, like, what's their hustles like as far as... Because some people do live painting. Some people do body painting. Some people do painting sips.
Yeah, I do. The only thing I've never done is a painting sip, but I would love to do a painting sip. I ain't got no problem with it.
So, we know recently... unfortunately, Mac Miller passed.
Damn, yeah. That's one of my favorite artists.
And it also got me to thinking as far as... we're not going to get into... I don't know if you know all the information as far as...
Not all of exactly it, because I think they're still doing toxicology and shit.
But that doesn't even matter, because I actually want to... It got me thinking as far as... We know that he was definitely dope lyricist, right?
Mm-hmm.
Where does Mac Miller stand? Mm-hmm. And this is even if he was alive... Don't just...
Right.
Not just because, you know, nostalgia.
Right.
But where does Mac Miller stand as far as amongst white rappers in history? Where does he rank?
Now, let me ask this question, because whenever people ask me about artist ranks, I ask them two different questions. Are we talking about success by the numbers, or are we talking about creativity?
Where does he rank on your personal list of your favorite white rappers?
He would be one.
He wouldn't be over Eminem.
I'd have him over him. And I'll tell you why I have him over him. The last Eminem album I enjoyed was the Eminem Show. I haven't enjoyed an Eminem album since then.
Who else is... Let's throw other white rappers on the table.
So if we're talking like... We talking M...
Are we talking everybody from the Beastie Boys? Just for...
Probably just the whole Beastie Boys as a collection.
Okay, the Beastie Boys as a collection. Probably so some people right there would just disagree with that.
Right.
I'm not one of them.
We probably put somebody like a Macklemore. Probably put like a Jeezy, MGK.
MGK.
Mac Miller.
Asher Bronson?
Action Bronson.
So, okay. Yeah, so honestly. So, yeah, to be honest with you, I have Eminem and Action Bronson before Mac Miller.
I have Mac and Action Bronson before him.
So you have Mac
and Action before him.
Mac, Action Bronson, and M?
Yeah.
So we just not even gonna acknowledge Bubba Sparks?
No.
Bubba Sparks. Don't do
Bubba
that.
Sparks is dope.
No, Bubba Sparks was dope.
He was
a South rapper, but he didn't
have the consistency.
But he was like, I don't want to say
tracks.
And not saying dope for a South or lyrical for a South.
Mm-hmm.
Cause we know there are people from the South that are lyrical.
Yeah.
But then there are a lot that aren't in the South. But for a South rapper, he was, I would say, a kind of lyrical one.
Yeah. But for me, when I look at Mac Miller, right, I've been...
Oh, how about Yellow Wolf?
He kind of tailed off.
Did you listen to some of his shit when it got a little bit...
I listened to, like, Radioactive and a couple of his other shit.
No, after that, though. He had, like, a drink that was a little bit more country music inspired, but it was actually kind of dope. But then, I don't know, I got to do some research... Because I don't want to just talk on my ass.
I
think I heard some racist shit recently. Where
he
had a flag or some shit.
He got kind of like Confederate flag.
Look.
I kind of fell off of that. I was just like, yeet. I was just like, nah, I'm not with it. But when it comes down to Mac Miller, right? The reason why I even put Mac Miller above him, for me, not numbers. Let's take away.
But he doesn't even have an Eminem show. But not to talk ill, but I'm just saying.
I would say he does.
Which one?
I would say if not the
face. The last.
I would say the Faces mixtape. I don't know if you ever heard it.
I've heard joints, but I'm not gonna say entirely.
If the Faces mixtape, the Define Feminine, and even the last album, Swimming.
The Define Feminine was definitely. And I listened to Swimming, but I have to I haven't got to live with it, but I've heard it.
I've lived with since Swimming came out. Like, I remember I listened to Astro World that night, and then in the morning I listened to Swimming for the rest of the day. Cause I really love
it. But I'm just saying, even fuck an album, I'm just saying.
But here's what
I'm just saying, as a lyricist, you don't have to put Eminem number one. As a lyricist.
Here's my thing, right? And here's why
I'm lyricist. Take him down.
And here's what.
That's
here's
just go rapping ability.
Let's go rapping ability, I'll put M1.
He jumped to one. Okay.
We just talking straight rapping ability.
Okay.
But the only thing with M is, as time has gone, his rapping ability has dipped.
I don't agree. I think he still can rap his ass off. I think it's less.
I kid you not, Revival.
No, that sucked. But did you listen to the new album?
I listened to Kamikaze, and I liked it up until halfway through the album.
Okay, but you overall like.
But Marshall Madden, Relapse, I didn't like.
I
didn't really like Recovery.
But Recovery had joints on it.
It had joints, but he was rapping his ass off. I'll give Recovery joints, he was rapping his ass off. Marshall Mathers LP 2, I didn't like. And then Revival, didn't like. And then Kamikaze.
All right, so just with your personal favorite, I got you. And that's cool. With your personal favorite, you got Mac Miller number one, Action Bronson number two.
And I would say.
So you said M number three?
Yeah, M would be three.
Just do five. Number four?
It'd be one Mac, two Action, three M. I put four MGK, five Jeezy. I wouldn't even put Macklemore. I'm not even a Macklemore fan.
Can you give an honorable mention? I'm going to do my list now.
I'll probably put Macklemore.
No, I'm saying somebody you're not thinking about. So I'm going to go number one. I'm going to go Eminem.
Okay.
Number two, I'm going to go Action Bronson because I really fuck with Action Bronson.
I love Action.
Number three. Yeah, I guess I'll go Mac Miller, number three. Number four. I thought Asher Roth was dope.
So
I'm gonna put Asher Roth on my four.
I'm not gonna lie, he got.
And you know who I'm gonna put on my five just to have some fucking respect? Ugh. We're not gonna be like a super New York podcast. Out of respect, I'm gonna go Paul Wall with number five.
You know what? Okay, so if I had to put five, I would probably put.
Were you even thinking about? Just admit that you weren't thinking about Paul Wall.
No, you said Paul Wall, I didn't even think about Paul.
You forgot he was even a person.
No, you know why? Because I was really into that Southern shit when it happened like that.
But that Houston shit was dope.
You know what's crazy? Paul Wall just, and this might sound crazy, I don't think of Paul Wall as a white MC.
Nah, no, but he is. You thought that he was light skin, right?
I just really don't think about it.
But that nigga light skin.
But I would put Paul Wall as five, and then I put Asher Roth in my honorable mention.
Okay.
But here's the thing with Mac Miller. Because I was a fan from him from Kids. Because when I first heard his Kids mixtape, I was like 19. I was in college.
Okay.
So I've been a fan of him since then. I didn't really like Blue Side Park, his first album. I was So it wasn't like I was always a fan.
I got you. But you just fucked with him.
And then it was like, as he creatively got up there, a lot of his shit also reflected where I was in my life. So a lot of that shit, like Faces, was like super depressing and drugged out. And that was kind of like through a depressing time for me. And his shit just...
grew with him.
Yeah, and his sound grew.
Yeah.
Like, him doing his own
production. Nah, you always have artists like that you grew up with.
So, my thing was just, like, from an overall creative artist, to me, I have Mac Miller over him.
Before we get the fuck out of here, you only could pick one.
Right.
Just one.
Okay.
So far, because we got a couple of months left. A few months left. Best album. Best hip-hop album of 2018.
Denzel Curry, Taboo.
He wanted to be viewed, pick an abstract pick.
Nah, that's not even that album goes fucking hard. Like, lyrically, he's switching up flows. He's just a lot of flow switches.
So that's the best album of the year so far. Yeah,
after that I've heard.
Better than Pusha T's album.
Yes, I have Pusha T too.
Better than Drake's album.
I don't have Drake in my top five.
Okay. I don't know, I'm just baiting you.
Yeah.
How better than, you don't even have to get into that. Mm-hmm. Better than everything that they drop with good music?
Yeah. I would like, the closest I have is like Pusha T at 2 and Kid C Ghost at 3. And I know people might ask me, even better than J. Cole album.
All right, but we just doing one. Mm-hmm. So you pick yours.
I got Denzel Curry.
I'm going to have to go Pusher, man. For right now, I'm going to have to go Pusher.
It's close between Pusher and
I'm going to have to go Pusher. I'm going to have to go Pusher one. And you know what? I'm sorry. I know I'm not in the majority, but I liked Nas' album a lot, to be honest with you.
I liked it.
And I really liked all of the good music releases. So I kind of put them all just back-to-back to me and jumbled. But And then, honestly, Drake's album grew on me. Sorry to say it. But I didn't like it at first. I was hating on it at first. I was like, it should just...
I went from thinking it was trash to like, it's okay.
Exactly.
So I think it's okay.
So you'll be loving that shit by fucking next summer.
Yeah, holler at me next year. Exactly. Let's see how I'm holding up next year to see how I feel.
All right, so you're number one?
Denzel Curry, Taboo.
I'm going to check it out.
Yeah.
But I'm going to give it to Pusher for my number one right now. But yeah, man, this has been our first episode.
This shit was fun. I'm excited.
Yeah, we're gonna just keep talking good art shit, good music shit.
Yeah.
You know, we know experts. We just
giving our opinions.
Giving our
how
opinions.
How we feel.
You know, we're not always politically correct.
Oh, hell no.
we're not fake woke.
There's too many of that.
We just that's a whole nother. That's a whole
yeah,
nother topic.
We ain't gonna get into that.
But yeah, man, tune in. Stay tuned, rather.
Exactly. Next week.
And we'll be consistent. All right?
Yep. Yeah.